Thank you for joining Wars of the Roses. And this video is on an article about Blavatsky by Manly P. Hall from the All-Seeing Eye, Volume 3, Number 15, March the 2nd, 1927. Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, the most remarkable woman of the modern world. It is our intent to publish during the next 7 weeks brief accounts of seven great figures in the occult and philosophical worlds. We present as the first of this series the most remarkable woman of the modern world, Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, a Russian mystic and philosopher to whom the world is indebted for the most complete outline now in print of the doctrines and mysteries of the ancient and modern worlds, both Eastern and Western. It is impossible to estimate the influence of this woman. She was a forerunner, and the modern tolerance for metaphysical and oriental thought is largely the result of her years of labor. Madame Blavatsky was born in Ekaterinoslav, Russia, in July 1831. At the age of 17, she married a Russian officer, Nisifor Blavatsky, many years her senior. She lived with him but a few months and then began a life of wandering, which included travel in Mexico, Canada, India, and Tibet. With the assistance of Colonel Henry Steele Alcott, she founded the Theosophical Society in New York City in 1875. Madame Blavatsky was made an American citizen and declared that her citizenship papers were one of her most cherished possessions. She wrote a number of books, of which The Secret Doctrine and Isis Unveiled are the most important. She also edited a magazine which she called Lucifer, the Light Bearer. She died suddenly in London while working on the third and fourth volumes of The Secret Doctrine. Madame Blavatsky was a pioneer in the Western world, for she brought to Europe and America the first connected account of the Eastern schools of occult philosophy. A woman of commanding personality and scintillating mentality, she demanded and secured respect for ideals far in advance of her age. In her two great works, she acts as the mouthpiece of a very seclusive group of Eastern adepts, known as masters or mahatmas, dwelling in the unexplored vastness of Greater and Lesser Tibet. She makes no claim to have written The Secret Doctrine, but states that she was merely a pen in the hand of a ready writer. Modern students should not lightly consider these works, for to contradict her is to contradict the illustrious brotherhood who chose her to serve them. There is no doubt that Madame Blavatsky possessed superphysical powers similar to those in East Indian adepts. She demonstrated these many times. Most of her work was carried on under bitter opposition from all sides, from the scientist, the theologian, the man of the world, and even in the spite of treachery among her own followers. During all this time, she was in continuous poor health, the result of exposures in early life. While she never claimed to be an initiate, there is every reason to suppose that she had been admitted at least into the lower or lesser mysteries, and consequently was privileged to use the title initiate. It would pay everyone to study her books, for the vast field of information on the ancient cultures and philosophies, and it would especially be valuable for the student of the occult to depart from less important books and study The Secret Doctrine. When we say this, a great cry will go up by the student. Oh, a book like The Secret Doctrine is so difficult, I can't understand it. Give me something more simple. We answer, what is the good of studying things you understand? The eternal cry of man is, make it easy. We do not realize that we must grow up to things. It is a great mistake to attempt to bring truth down to ignorance. The result is always misunderstanding and perversion. Man must be brought up to the truth. He should eternally aspire towards the highest. He must never seek to drag things spiritually down to his level. The secret doctrine is difficult to read. Its long words, its abstract ideas, and its complicated system of thought bewilder the uninitiated. But man must realize that his mind is capable of all things if he will train it, if he will live the occult life as set forth by the masters for their pupils. He will unfold his mind, thus increasing his intelligence to the understanding of those things which before were riddles and enigmas. So to this great Russian woman, this mystic and philosopher, we owe the right to think along lines opposed to and beyond the restrictions of orthodoxy. Whether religious or scientific, this woman battled consistently to bring a deeper sympathy and insight into the world of thought for the realities back of the form or the externals. A woman, misunderstood and slandered as few in the modern world have been, and at the same time strong enough to combat successfully all of her foes. She represents the possible power of woman in the new era of science and philosophy. Future generations will recognize the true genius of this most remarkable of modern women. Do you know that Napoleon Bonaparte turned down as impractical the plans for the first submarine? Do you know that the ruler of the East Indian state of Baroda has the finest collection of pearls in the world? Do you know that the fashion of ornamenting the upper ends of gateposts with knobs is a survival of the ancient savage custom of mounting the skulls of enemies on either side of the doorway? Do you know that the ancient Britons, being unable to temper the metal used in the making of swords, were forced to stop every little while and straighten out their bent swords and blades before continuing their fighting? Do you know that one of Sarah Bernhardt's friends presented her with a coffin, which she always carried about with her, lest, in her own words, she should die suddenly without sufficient cash to supply one? Do you know that the gypsies are in all probability the descendants of the priest of the Egyptian temple of Serapis at Alexandria, driven into exile by the destruction of that edifice by Theodosius, the Christian emperor? Do you know that the Hindu emperor, Akbar the Great, one of the most illustrious Mughal rulers, used to play chess with the native princes in the courtyard of the palace? All the pieces were living men dressed in varicolored costumes. Do you know that the ancient Egyptian women bobbed their hair, rouged their lips, painted their faces, wore short skirts, high heels, thus possessing nearly all the traits of the modern flapper? Do you know that while the ancient Romans do not possess spectacles, they were able to aid failing eyesight by constructing rings in which was set an upright transparent or partially transparent gem polished in the shape of a magnifying glass? By squinting with one eye, they were thus able to read through their rings. Thank you for watching. Please don't forget to share, like, subscribe, and comment. And if you can, please consider donating a little to Wars of the Roses. Links to PayPal and Patreon are in the description. Thank you very much.